Recorded Books presents a sci-fi audio production, Berserker, by Fred Saberhagen. This unabridged recording is narrated by Aaron Lustig with Henry Strozier. This book is copyrighted 1967 by Fred Saberhagen. This recording is copyrighted 1983 by Recorded Books. Sci-fi audio is an imprint dedicated exclusively to science fiction and fantasy titles on CD, from classics to bestsellers, cult hits to critically acclaimed award winners. Long ago, in a distant part of the galaxy, two alien races met and fought a war of mutual extinction. The sole legacy of that war was the weapon that ended it, the death machines, the Berserkers. Guided by self-aware computers more intelligent than any human, these world-sized battlecraft carved a swath of death through the galaxy until they arrived at the outskirts of the fledgling Empire of Man. And now, Berserker.
Introduction. I, third historian of the Carpen race, in gratitude to the Earth-descended race for their defense of my world, set down here for them my fragmentary vision of their great war against our common enemy. The vision has been formed piece by piece through my contacts in past and present time with the minds of men and of machines. In these minds alien to me, I often perceive what I cannot understand, yet what I see is true. And so I have truly set down the acts and words of Earth-descended man, great and small and ordinary, the words and even the secret thoughts of your heroes and your traitors. Looking into the past, I have seen how in the 20th century of your Christian calendar, your forefathers on Earth first built radio detectors capable of sounding the deeps of interstellar space. On the day when whispers in our alien voices were first detected, straying in across the enormous intervals, the universe of stars became real to all Earth's nations and all her tribes. They became aware of the real world surrounding them, a universe strange and immense beyond thought, possibly hostile, surrounding and shrinking all Earthmen alike. Like island savages just become aware of the great powers existing on and beyond their ocean, your nations began sullenly, mistrustfully, almost against their will, to put aside their quarrels with one another. In the same century, the men of old Earth took their first steps into space. They studied our alien voices whenever they could hear us. And when the men of old Earth began to travel faster than light, they followed our voices to seek us out. Your race and mine studied each other with eager science and with great caution and courtesy. We Carpen and our older friends are more passive than you. We live in different environments and think mainly in different directions. We posed no threat to Earth. We saw to it that Earthmen were not crowded by our presence. Physically and mentally, they had to stretch to touch us. Ours, all the skills of keeping peace. Alas, for the day unthinkable that was to come, the day when we wished ourselves warlike. You of Earth found uninhabited planets where you could thrive in the warmth of suns much like your own. In large colonies and small, you scattered yourselves across one segment of one arm of our slow-turning galaxy. To your settlers and frontiersmen, the galaxy began to seem a friendly place, rich in worlds hanging ripe for your peaceful occupation. The alien immensity surrounding you appeared to be not hostile after all. Imagined threats had receded behind horizons of silence and vastness. And so once more you allowed among yourselves the luxury of dangerous conflict, carrying the threat of suicidal violence. No enforceable law existed among the planets. On each of your scattered colonies, individual leaders maneuvered for personal power, distracting their people with real or imagined dangers posed by other Earth-descended men. All further exploration was delayed. In the very days when the new and inexplicable radio voices were first heard drifting in from beyond your frontiers. The strange, soon to be terrible voices that conversed only in mathematics. Earth and Earth's colonies were divided each against all by suspicion, and in mutual fear were rapidly training and arming for war. And at this point, the very readiness for violence that had sometimes so nearly destroyed you proved to be the means of life's survival. To us, the Karmpen Watchers, the withdrawn seers and touchers of minds, it appeared that you had carried the crushing weight of war through all your history, knowing that it would at last be needed, that this hour would strike when nothing less awful would serve. When the hour struck and our enemy came without warning, you were ready with swarming battle fleets. You were dispersed and dug in on scores of planets and heavily armed. Because you were, some of you and some of us are now alive. Not all our Karmpen psychology, our logic and vision and subtlety would have availed us anything. The skills of peace and tolerance were useless, for our enemy was not alive. What is thought? That mechanism seems to bring it forth.
Without a thought. The machine was a vast fortress, containing no life, set by its long-dead masters to destroy anything that lived. It and many others like it were the inheritance of Earth, from some war fought between unknown interstellar empires, in some time that could hardly be connected with any earthly calendar. One such machine could hang over a planet colonized by men, and in 2 days pound the surface into a lifeless cloud of dust and steam, 100 miles deep. This particular machine had already done just that. It used no predictable tactics in its dedicated, unconscious war against life. The ancient unknown gamesman had built it as a random factor, to be loosed in the enemy's territory to do what damage it might. Men thought its plan of battle was chosen by the random disintegrations of atoms in a block of some long-lived isotope buried deep inside it, and so was not even in theory predictable by opposing brains, human or electronic. Men called it a berserker. Del Murray, sometime computer specialist, had called it other names than that, but right now he was too busy to waste breath, as he moved in staggering lunges around the little cabin of his one-man fighter, plugging in replacement units for equipment damaged by the last near miss of a berserker missile. An animal resembling a large dog with an ape's forelegs moved around the cabin too, carrying in its nearly human hands a supply of emergency sealing patches. The cabin air was filled with haze. Wherever movement of the haze showed a leak to an unpressurized part of the hull, the dog ape moved to apply a patch. "Hello, Foxglove," the man shouted, hoping that his radio was again in working order. "Hello, Murray, this is Foxglove," said a sudden loud voice in the cabin. "How far did you get?" Dell was too worried to show much relief that his communications were open again. "I'll let you know in a minute. At least it stopped shooting at me for a while. Move, Newton." The alien animal, pet and ally called an ion, moved away from the man's feet and kept single-mindedly looking for leaks. After another minute's work, Dell could strap his body into the deep cushioned command chair again with something like an operational panel before him. That last near miss had sprayed the whole cabin with fine, penetrating splinters. It was remarkable that man and ion had come through unwounded. His radar working again, Dell could say, "I'm about 90 miles out from it, Foxglove, on the opposite side from you." His present position was the one he had been trying to achieve since the battle had begun. The two Earth ships and the Berserker were half a light year from the nearest sun. The Berserker could not leap out of normal space toward the defenseless colonies of the planets of that sun, while the two ships stayed close to it. There were only two men aboard Foxglove. They had more machinery working for them than did Dell, but both manned ships were mites compared to their opponent. Dell's radar showed him an ancient ruin of metal, not much smaller in cross-section than New Jersey. Men had blown holes in it the size of Manhattan Island and melted puddles of slag as big as lakes upon its surface. But the Berserker's power was still enormous. So far, no man had fought it and survived. Now it could squash Dell's little ship like a mosquito. It was wasting its unpredictable subtlety on him. Yet there was a special taste of terror in the very difference of it. Men could never frighten this enemy as it had frightened them. Earthmen's tactics, worked out from bitter experience against other Berserkers, called for a simultaneous attack by three ships. Foxglove and Murray made two. A third was supposedly on the way, but still about 8 hours distant, moving at C-plus velocity outside of normal space. Until it arrived, Foxglove and Murray must hold the Berserker at bay, while it brooded unguessable schemes. It might attack either ship at any moment, or it might seek to disengage. It might wait hours for them to make the first move, though it would certainly fight if the men attacked it. It had learned the language of Earth's spacemen. It might try to talk with them. But always, ultimately, it would seek to destroy them and every other living thing it met. That was the basic command given it by the ancient warlords. 1,000 years ago, it would easily have swept ships of the type that now opposed it from its path, whether they carried fusion missiles or not. Now it was in some electrical way conscious of its own weakening by accumulated damage. And perhaps, in long centuries of fighting its way across the galaxy, it had learned to be wary. Now, quite suddenly, Dell's detectors showed force fields forming in behind his ship. Like the encircling arms of a huge bear, they blocked his path away from the enemy. He waited for some deadly blow, with his hand trembling over the red button that would salvo his atomic missiles at the Berserker. But if he attacked alone or even with Foxglove, the infernal machine would parry their missiles, crush their ships, and go on to destroy another helpless planet. Three ships were needed to attack. The red firing button was now only a last desperate resort. Dell was reporting the force fields to Foxglove when he felt the first hint in his mind of another attack. "Newton," he called sharply, leaving the radio connection with Foxglove open. They would hear and understand what was going to happen. The ion bounded instantly from its combat couch to stand before Dell as if hypnotized, all attention riveted on the man. Dell had sometimes bragged, "Show Newton a drawing of different colored lights, convince him it represents a particular control panel, and he'll push buttons or whatever you tell him until the real panel matches the drawing." But no ion had the human ability to learn and to create on an abstract level, which was why Dell was now going to put Newton in command of his ship. He switched off the ship's computers. They were going to be useless as his own brain under the attack he felt gathering, and said to Newton, "Situation zombie." The animal responded instantly, as it had been trained, seizing Dell's hands with firm insistence and dragging them one at a time down beside the command chair to where the fetters had been installed. Hard experience had taught men something about the Berserker's mind weapon, although its principles of operation were still unknown. It was slow in its onslaught, and its effects could not be steadily maintained for more than about 2 hours, after which a Berserker was evidently forced to turn it off for an equal time. But while in effect, it robbed any human or electronic brain of the ability to plan or to predict, and left it unconscious of its own incapacity. It seemed to Dell that all this had happened before, maybe more than once. Newton, that funny fellow, had gone too far with his pranks. He had abandoned the little boxes of colored beads that were his favorite toys and was moving the controls around at the lighted panel. Unwilling to share the fun with Dell, he had tied the man to his chair somehow. Such behavior was really intolerable, especially when there was supposed to be a battle in progress. Dell tried to pull his hands free and called to Newton. Newton whined earnestly and stayed at the panel. "Newt, you dog, come, let me loose. I know what I have to say. 4 score and 7... Hey, Newt, where are your toys? Let me see your pretty beads." There were hundreds of tiny boxes of the vari-colored beads, leftover trade goods that Newton loved to sort out and handle. Dell peered around the cabin, chuckling a little at his own cleverness. He would get Newton distracted by the beads, and then... The vague idea faded into other crackbrain grotesqueries. Newton whined now and then, but stayed at the panel, moving controls in the long sequence he had been taught, taking the ship through the fainting, evasive maneuvers that might fool a berserker into thinking it was still competently manned. Newton never put a hand near the big red button. Only if he felt deadly pain himself, or found a dead man in Dell's chair, would he reach for that. Roger, Murray, said the radio from time to time, as if acknowledging a message. Sometimes Foxglove added a few words or numbers that might have meant something. Dell wondered what the talking was about. At last he understood that Foxglove was trying to help maintain the illusion that there was still a competent brain in charge of Dell's ship. The fear reaction came when he began to realize that he had once again lived through the effect of the mind weapon. The brooding berserker, half-genius, half-idiot, had forborne to press the attack when success would have been certain, perhaps deceived, perhaps following the strategy that avoided predictability at almost any cost. Newton! The animal turned, hearing a change in his voice. Now Dell could say the words that would tell Newton it was safe to set his master free, a sequence too long for anyone under the mind weapon to recite. "Shall not perish from the earth," he finished. With a yelp of joy, Newton pulled the fetters from Dell's hands. Dell turned instantly to the radio. "Effect has evidently been turned off, Foxglove," said Dell's voice through the speaker in the cabin of the larger ship. The commander let out a sigh. "He's back in control." The second officer, there was no third, said, "That means we've got some kind of fighting chance for the next 2 hours. I say let's attack now." The commander shook his head, slowly but without hesitation. "With 2 ships, we don't have any real chance. Less than 4 hours until Gizmo gets here. We have to stall until then if we want to win." "It'll attack the next time it gets Dell's mind scrambled. I don't think we fooled it for a minute. We're out of range of the mind beam here, but Dell can't withdraw now, and we can't expect that ion to fight a ship for him. We'll really have no chance with Dell gone." The commander's eyes moved ceaselessly over his panel. "We'll wait. We can't be sure it'll attack the next time it puts the beam on him." The berserker spoke suddenly, its radioed voice plain in the cabin of both ships. "I have a proposition for you, little ship." Its voice had a cracking, adolescent quality, because it strung together words and syllables recorded from the voices of human prisoners of both sexes and different ages. Bits of human emotion, sorted and fixed like butterflies on pins, thought the commander. There was no reason to think it had kept the prisoners alive after learning the language from them. "Well?" Dell's voice sounded tough and capable by comparison. "I have invented a game which we will play," it said. "If you play well enough, I will not kill you right away." "Now I've heard everything," murmured the second officer. After 3 thoughtful seconds, the commander slammed a fist on the arm of his chair. "It means to test his learning ability, to run a continuous check on his brain while it turns up the power of the mind beam and tries different modulations. If it can make sure the mind beam is working, it'll attack instantly. I'll bet my life on it. That's the game it's playing this time." "I will think over your proposition," said Dell's voice coolly. The commander said, "It's in no hurry to start. It won't be able to turn on the mind beam again for almost 2 hours." "But we need another 2 hours beyond that," Dell's voice said. "Describe the game you want to play."
"It is a simplified version of the human game called checkers."
The commander and the second looked at each other, neither able to imagine Newton able to play checkers. Nor could they doubt that Newton's failure would kill them within a few hours and leave another planet open to destruction. After a minute's silence, Dell's voice asked, "What do we use for a board?"
"We will radio our moves to one another," said the berserker equably. It went on to describe a checkers-like game, played on a smaller board with less than the normal number of pieces. There was nothing very profound about it, but of course, playing would seem to require a functional brain, human or electronic, able to plan and to predict. If I agree to play, said Dell slowly, how will we decide who gets to move first?
He's trying to stall, said the commander, gnawing a thumbnail. We won't be able to offer any advice with that thing listening. Oh, stay sharp, Dell boy.
To simplify matters, said the berserker, I will move first in every game.
Dell could look forward to another hour free of the mind weapon when he finished rigging the checkerboard. When the pegged pieces were moved, appropriate signals would be radioed to the berserker. Lighted squares on the board would show him where its pieces were moved. If it spoke to him while the mind weapon was on, Dell's voice would answer from a tape, which he had stocked with vaguely aggressive phrases such as, get on with the game, or do you want to give up now? He hadn't told the enemy how far along he was with his preparations, because he was still busy with something that the enemy must not know, the system that was going to enable Newton to play a game of simplified checkers. Dell gave a soundless little laugh as he worked, and glanced over to where Newton was lounging on his couch, clutching toys in his hands as if he drew some comfort from them. This scheme was going to push the iron near the limit of his ability, but Dell saw no reason why it should fail. Dell had completely analyzed the miniature checker game and diagrammed every position that Newton could possibly face, playing only even-numbered moves, thank the random berserker for that specification, on small cards. Dell had discarded some lines of play that would arise from some poor early moves by Newton, further simplifying his job. Now, on a card showing each possible remaining position, Dell indicated the best possible move with a drawn-in arrow. Now he could quickly teach Newton to play the game by looking at the appropriate card and making the move shown by the arrow.
Uh-oh, said Dell as his hands stopped working and he stared into space. Newton whined at the tone of his voice.
Once Dell had sat at one board in a simultaneous chess exhibition, one of 60 players opposing the world champion, Blankenship. Dell had held his own into the middle of the game. Then, when the great man paused again opposite his board, Dell had shoved a pawn forward, thinking he had reached an unassailable position and could begin a counterattack. Blankenship had moved a rook to an innocent-looking square and strolled on to the next board. And then Dell had seen the checkmate coming at him, four moves away, but one move too late for him to do anything about it. The commander suddenly said a foul phrase in a loud, distinct voice. Such conduct on his part was extremely rare, and the second officer looked round in surprise. What?
I think we've had it, the commander paused. I hope that Murray could set up some kind of a system over there so that Newton could play the game, or appear to be playing it, but it won't work. Whatever system Newton plays by rote will always have him making the same move in the same position. It may be a perfect system, but a man doesn't play any game that way, damn it. He makes mistakes. He changes strategy. Even in a game this simple, there'll be room for that. Most of all, a man learns a game as he plays it. He gets better as he goes along. That's what'll give Newton away, and that's what our bandit wants. It's probably heard about irons. Now, as soon as it can be sure it's facing a dumb animal over there and not a man or a computer.
After a little while, the second officer said, I'm getting signals of their moves. They've begun play. Maybe we should have rigged up a board so we could follow along with the game.
We better just be ready to go at it when the time comes.
The commander looked hopelessly at his salvo button, and then at the clock that showed 2 hours must pass before Gizmo could reasonably be hoped for. Soon the second officer said, That seems to be the end of the first game. Dell lost it, if I'm reading their scoreboard signal right. He paused.
Sir, here's that signal we picked up the last time it turned the mind beam on. Dell must be starting to get it again.
There was nothing for the commander to say. The two men waited silently for the enemy's attack, hoping only that they could damage it in the seconds before it would overwhelm them and kill them.
He's playing the second game, said the second officer, puzzled. And I just heard him say, Let's get on with it.
His voice could be recorded. He must have made some plan of play for Newton to follow. But it won't fool the berserker for long, it can't.
Time crept unmeasurably past them.
The second said, He's lost the first four games, but he's not making the same moves every time. I wish we'd made a board.
Shut up about the board. We'd be watching it instead of the panel. Now stay alert, mister. After what seemed a long time, the second said, "Well, I'll be."
"What? Our side got a draw in that game."
"And the beam can't be on him. Are you sure?"
"It is. Look here, the same indication we got last time. It's been on him the better part of an hour and getting stronger."
The commander stared in disbelief, but he knew and trusted his second's ability, and the panel indications were convincing. He said,
"Then someone, or something, with no functioning mind is learning how to play a game over there."
"Ha ha," he added as if trying to remember how to laugh. The Berserker won another game. Another draw. Another win for the enemy, then three draw games in a row. Once the second officer heard Dell's voice ask coolly, "Do you want to give up now?" On the next move, he lost another game, but the following game ended in another draw. Dell was plainly taking more time than his opponent to move, but not enough time to make the enemy impatient.
"It's trying different modulations of the mind beam," said the second, "and it's got the power turned way up."
"Yeah," said the commander. Several times he had almost tried to radio Dell to say something that might keep the man's spirits up, and also to relieve his own feverish inactivity, and to try to find out what could possibly be going on. But he couldn't take the chance. Any interference might upset the miracle. He could not believe the inexplicable success could last, even when the checker match turned gradually into an endless succession of drawn games between two perfect players. Hours ago, the commander had said goodbye to life and hope, and he still waited for the fatal moment. And he waited.
"Not perish from the earth," said Del Murray, and Newton's eager hands flew to loose his right arm from its shackle. A game, unfinished on the little board before him, had been abandoned seconds earlier. The mind beam had been turned off at the same time, when Gizmo had burst into normal space right in position and only 5 minutes late, and the Berserker had been forced to turn all its energies to meet the immediate all-out attack of Gizmo and Foxglove. Dell saw his computers, recovering from the effect of the beam, lock his aiming screen onto the Berserker's scarred and bulging midsection as he shot his right arm forward, scattering pieces from the game board.
"Checkmate!" he roared out hoarsely, and brought his fist down on the big red button.
"I'm glad it didn't want to play chess," Dell said later, talking to the commander in Foxglove's cabin. "I could never have rigged that up."
The ports were cleared now, and the men could look out at the cloud of expanding gas, still faintly luminous, that had been a Berserker, metal fire purged of the legacy of ancient evil. But the commander was watching Dell.
"You got Newt to play by following diagrams, I see that. But how could he learn the game?"
Dell grinned.
"He couldn't, but his toys could. Now wait before you slug me."
He called the iron to him and took a small box from the animal's hand. The box rattled faintly as he held it up. On the cover was pasted a diagram of one possible position in the simplified checker game, with a different colored arrow indicating each possible move of Dell's pieces.
"It took a couple of hundred of these boxes," said Dell.
This one was in the group that Newt examined for the fourth move. When he found a box with a diagram matching the position on the board, he picked the box up, pulled out one of these beads from inside without looking. That was the hardest part to teach him in a hurry, by the way, said Dell, demonstrating.
This one's blue. That means make the move indicated on the cover by a blue arrow. Now the orange arrow leads to a poor position, see?
Dell shook all the beads out of the box into his hand.
No orange beads left. There were six of each color when we started, but every time Newton drew a bead, he had orders to leave it out of the box until the game was over. Then, if the scoreboard indicated a loss for our side, he went back and threw away all the beads he had used. All the bad moves were gradually eliminated. In a few hours, Newt and his boxes learned to play the game perfectly.
Well, said the commander. He thought for a moment, then reached down to scratch Newton behind the ears.
I never would have come up with that idea. I should have thought of it sooner. The basic idea is a couple of centuries old, and computers are supposed to be my business.
This could be a big thing, said the commander.
I mean, your basic idea might be useful to any task force that has to face a Berserker's mind beam.
Yeah? Dell grew reflective.
Also,
what?
I was thinking of a guy I met once, named Blankenship. I wonder if I could rig something up.
Yes, I, third historian, have touched living minds, earth minds, so deadly cool that for a while they could see war as a game. The first decades of the Berserker War they were forced to see as a game being lost for life. Nearly all the terrors of the slaughters in your past were present in this vaster war, all magnified in time and space. It was even less a game than any war has ever been. As the grim length of the Berserker War dragged on, even Earthmen discovered in it certain horrors that they had never known before. Behold.
Goodlife.
It's only a machine, Hemphill, said the dying man in a small voice.
Hemphill, drifting weightless in near darkness, heard him with only faint contempt and pity. Let the wretch go out timidly, forgiving the universe everything, if he found the going out easier that way. Hemphill kept on staring out through the port, at the dark, crenellated shape that blotted out so many of the stars. There was probably just this one compartment of the passenger ship left livable, with three people in it and the air whining out in steady leaks that would soon exhaust the emergency tanks. The ship was a wreck, torn and beaten, yet Hemphill's view of the enemy was steady. It must be a force of the enemy's that kept the wreck from spinning. Now, the young woman, another passenger, came drifting across the compartment to touch Hemphill on the arm. He thought her name was Maria something. "Listen," she began, "do you think we might..." In her voice there was no despair, but the tone of planning, and so Hemphill had begun to listen to her, but she was interrupted. The very walls of the cabin reverberated, driven like speaker diaphragms through the power of the enemy force field that still gripped the butchered hull. The quavering voice of the Berserker machine came in.
"You who can still hear me live on. I plan to spare you. I am sending a boat to save you from death."
Hemphill was sick with frustrated rage. He had never heard a Berserker's voice in reality before, but still it was familiar as an old nightmare. He could feel the woman's hand pull away from his arm, and then he saw that in his rage he had raised both his hands to be claws, then fists that almost smashed themselves against the port. The damn thing wanted to take him inside it. Of all people in space, it wanted to make him prisoner. A plan rose instantly in his mind and flowed smoothly into action. He spun away from the port. There were warheads, for small defensive missiles, here in this compartment. He remembered seeing them. The other surviving man, a ship's officer, dying slowly, bleeding through his uniform tatters, saw what Hemphill was doing in the wreckage and drifted in front of him interferingly. "You can't do that. You'll only destroy the boat it sends. If it lets you do that much, there may be other people still alive here." The man's face had been upside down before Hemphill as the two of them drifted. As their movement let them see each other in normal position, the wounded man stopped talking, gave up and rotated himself away, drifting inertly as if already dead. Hemphill could not hope to manage a whole warhead, but he could extract the chemical explosive detonator of a size to carry under one arm. All passengers had put on emergency spacesuits when the unequal battle had begun. Now he found himself an extra air tank and some officer's laser pistol, which he stuck in a loop of his suit's belt. The girl approached him again. He watched her warily.
"Do it," she said with quiet conviction, while the three of them spun slowly in the near darkness and the air leaks whined. "Do it. The loss of a boat will weaken it, a little, for the next fight. And we here have no chance anyway."
"Yes." He nodded approvingly. This girl understood what was important. To hurt a Berserker, to smash, burn, destroy, to kill it finally. Nothing else mattered very much. He pointed to the wounded mate and whispered, "Don't let him give me away." She nodded silently.
It might hear them talking. If it could speak through these walls, it might be listening.
A boat's coming, said the wounded man in a calm and distant voice.
Goodlife, called the machine voice, cracking between syllables as always. Here.
He woke up with a start and got quickly to his feet. He had been dozing almost under the dripping end of a drinking water pipe.
Goodlife.
There were no speakers or scanners in this little compartment. The call came from some distance away.
Here.
He ran toward the call, his feet shuffling and thumping on metal. He had dozed off, being tired. Even though the battle had been a little one, there had been extra tasks for him, servicing and directing the commensal machines that roamed the endless ducts and corridors repairing damage. It was small help he could give, he knew. Now his head and neck bore sore spots from the helmet he had had to wear, and his body was chafed in places from the unaccustomed covering he had to put on it when a battle came. This time, happily, there had been no battle damage at all. He came to the flat glass eye of a scanner and shuffled to a stop, waiting.
Goodlife. The perverted machine has been destroyed, and the few bad lives left are helpless.
Yes. He jiggled his body up and down in happiness.
I remind you, life is evil, said the voice of the machine.
Life is evil. I am Goodlife, he said quickly, ceasing his jiggling. He did not think punishment impended, but he wanted to be sure.
Yes. Like your parents before you, you have been useful. Now I plan to bring other humans inside myself, to study them closely. Your next use will be with them in my experiments. I remind you, they are bad life. We must be careful.
Bad life. He knew that they were creatures shaped like himself, existing in the world beyond the machine. They caused the shudders and shocks and damage that made up a battle. Bad life, here. It was a chilling thought. He raised his own hands and looked at them, then turned his attention up and down the passage in which he stood, trying to visualize the bad life become real before him.
Go now to the medical room, said the machine. You must be immunized against disease before you approach the bad life.
Hemp Hill made his way from one ruined compartment to another, until he found a gash in the outer hull that was plugged nearly shut. While he wrenched at the obstructing material, he heard the clanging arrival of the Berserker's boat come for prisoners. He pulled harder, the obstruction gave way, and he was blown out into space. Around the wreck were hundreds of pieces of flotsam, held near by tenuous magnetism or perhaps by the Berserker's force fields. Hemphill found that his suit worked well enough. With its tiny jet, he moved around the shattered hull of the passenger ship to where the Berserker's boat had come to rest. The dark blot of the Berserker machine came into view against the starfield of deep space, battlemented like a fortified city of old, and larger than any such city had ever been. He could see that the Berserker's boat had somehow found the right compartment and clamped itself to the wrecked hull. It would be gathering in Maria and the wounded man. Fingers on the plunger that would set off his bomb, Hemphill drifted closer. On the brink of death, it annoyed him that he would never know with certainty that the boat was destroyed, and it was such a trifling blow to strike, such a small revenge. Still drifting closer, holding the plunger ready, he saw the puff of decompressed air moisture as the boat disconnected itself from the hull. The invisible force fields of the Berserker surged, tugging at the boat, at Hemphill, at bits of wreckage within yards of the boat. He managed to clamp himself to the boat before it was pulled away from him. He thought he had an hour's air in his suit tank, more than he would need. As the Berserker pulled him toward itself, Hemphill's mind hung over the brink of death. Hemphill's fingers gripped the plunger of his bomb. In his mind, his night-colored enemy was death. The black, scarred surface of it hurtled closer in the unreal starlight, becoming a planet toward which the boat fell. Hemphill still clung to the boat when it was pulled into an opening that could have accommodated many ships. The size and power of the Berserker were all around him, enough to overwhelm hate and courage alike. His little bomb was a pointless joke. When the boat touched at a dark internal dock, Hempel leapt away from it and scrambled to find a hiding place. As he cowered on a shadowed ledge of metal, his hand wanted to fire the bomb, simply to bring death and escape. He forced his hand to be still. He forced himself to watch while the two human prisoners were sucked from the boat through a pulsing transparent tube that passed out of sight through a bulkhead. Not knowing what he meant to accomplish, he pushed himself in the direction of the tube. He glided through the dark, enormous cavern almost weightlessly. The berserker's mass was enough to give it a small, natural gravity of its own. Within 10 minutes, he came upon an unmistakable airlock. It seemed to have been cut with a surrounding section of hull from some Earth warship and set into the bulkhead. Inside an airlock would be as good a place for a bomb as he was likely to find. He got the outer door open and went in, apparently without triggering any alarms. If he destroyed himself here, he would deprive the berserker of what? Why should it need an airlock at all? Not for prisoners, thought Hempel. If it sucks them in through a tube, hardly an entrance built for enemies. He tested the air on the lock and opened his helmet. For air-breathing friends the size of men? That was a contradiction. Everything that lived and breathed must be a berserker's enemy, except the unknown beings who had built it. Or so man had thought, until now. The inner door of the lock opened at Hemphill's push, and artificial gravity came on. He walked through into a narrow and badly lighted passage, his fingers ready on the plunger of his bomb.
"Go in, Goodlife," said the machine. "Look closely at each of them."
Goodlife made an uncertain sound in his throat, like a servo motor starting and stopping. He was gripped by a feeling that resembled hunger or the fear of punishment, because he was going to see life forms directly now, not as old images on a stage. Knowing the reason for the unpleasant feeling did not help. He stood hesitating outside the door of the room where the bad life was being kept. He had put on his suit again, as the machine had ordered. The suit would protect him if the bad life tried to damage him.
"Go in," the machine repeated.
"Maybe I'd better not," Goodlife said in misery, remembering to speak loudly and clearly. Punishment was always less likely when he did.
"Punish, punish," said the voice of the machine.
When it said the word twice, punishment was very near. As if already feeling in his bones the wrenching pain that left no damage, he opened the door quickly and stepped in. He lay on the floor, bloody and damaged, in strange, ragged suiting. And at the same time, he was still in the doorway. His own shape was on the floor, the same human form he knew, but now seen entirely from outside. More than an image, far more, it was himself now bilocated. There, here, himself, not himself, Goodlife fell back against the door. He raised his arm and tried to bite it, forgetting his suit. He pounded his suited arms violently together until there was bruised pain enough to nail him to himself where he stood. Slowly, the terror subsided. Gradually, his intellect could explain it and master it. "This is me. Here. Here in the doorway. That there on the floor, that is another life. Another body, corroded like me with vitality. Only far worse than I. That one on the floor is bad life." Maria Juarez had prayed continuously for a long time, her eyes closed. Cold and personal grippers had moved her this way and that. Her weight had come back, and there was air to breathe when her helmet and her suit.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.